When I say the phrase solved game, what do you think of? Do you think of something that has been solved, like a difficult Zelda shrine? Or a game that you beat, like freeing the end in Minecraft? Perhaps do you think of an actual puzzle game that requires a solution, like Baba Is You? Well, according to our friend Gamethin Theory, a solved game is a game, duh, whose outcomes, i.e. win, lose, or draw, can be predicted. Okay, so what does this mean? Basically, there exist what we call perfect moves, or moves which hopefully create an eventual victory for one player. One thing to note is that even playing perfect moves can result in a draw or loss depending on the game and the situation. A perfect move is the best possible move in that situation. We will find that there are different levels of solved games, because some games can be won from any position, but some need a perfect sequence of moves to win from the starting position. Throughout this video, we're going to look at the different tiers of solved games, and then look through a certain mathematical lens of what this may also look like using game theory and linear algebra, so stick around to find out. To start, there are three different types of solved games: strongly solved games, weakly solved games, and ultra-weakly solved games. I know, not the most consistent naming, but I won't complain. A lot. Now, why? To start, a strongly solved game is a game where some algorithm can find perfect moves from any position, even if either player has made a mistake. For example, Connect 4 is a strongly solved game. That is, an algorithm can find perfect moves for either player. A reminder though, a perfect move does not mean the move will make the player win their game, it will only help them. If a player is already in a losing Connect 4 position, a perfect move won't help too much. Fun fact though, the perfect move for Connect 4 at the start of the game is for the first player to go in the middle spot, which guarantees a victory, given they play perfectly. Moving on, a weakly solved game is a game where some algorithm can provide perfect moves, but only from the starting position. The difference between this and a strongly solved game is that the strongly solved game algorithms provide perfect moves from any position, not just the starting position. Checkers is an example of a weakly solved game. An ultra weakly solved game is a game where you can prove whether the first player will win, lose, or draw from the initial position, given both sides only play perfect moves. Fun fact for ultra weak proofs, you don't actually need to say the perfect moves, you just need to say if it's possible. The game of Hex is an example of an ultra weakly solved game. Before you look at solved games through a linear algebra lens, could you consider liking and subscribing? It helps the channel by recommending this video to others like you who may benefit from watching this video. Thanks, and back to the video. Okay though, there are different levels of how a game can be solved, but what does this look like mathematically? Before we begin, I would like to preface this by saying that games are categorized in game theory. For example, we have symmetric and asymmetric games, zero-sum games, sequential and simultaneous games, combinatorial games, Bayesian games, incomplete games, and video games, just to name a few. I won't go into detail about the different types of games, so if you're interested, I suggest searching up the different types of games. Also note that some games can be in multiple categories at once, depending on the nature of the game. But anyways, the type of game we will talk about today is a complete game. That is, both players have what we call complete information over the game, meaning they are both aware of the payoffs and potential strategies in the game. This doesn't mean that players know what the other player will play though. You can think of it like rock, paper, scissors, where both players know exactly what will happen depending on what both of them play, but they don't know what the other person will play. To help understand this better, let's construct a game between arbitrary player A and player B. Let's say both players have three coins, a penny, nickel, and dime. Each round, both players put out a coin at the same time. There are two rules on who wins what. 1. Whoever plays the coin with the higher value takes both coins, and 2. If both players play the same coin, player B will take both coins. We can then construct a payoff matrix for player A that looks something like this. But how do we read this? Each cell in the matrix shows how much A will gain or lose from each play. For example, we can see that if both A and B play nickel, then A will lose 5 cents. Also, a bit of a fun fact, but we call this sort of game a zero-sum game, because no outside coins are being added. We can also think of it like this. If I add how much B will gain or lose in each cell, the value in each cell adds to 0 and the sum of every cell in the matrix adds to 0. But back to the game, some of you may be catching on, but what is the best move for player A? Is it dime because if player B plays nickel it has the highest possible payoff? But player B knows that too and will play dime to counter. Actually, if we look at the third column, it seems that no matter what we play, if player B plays dime, we will lose. But we can still be smart about this. I mean, we're losing no matter what, but it's just another day for us, so. But anyways, we notice that if we actually play penny, player B will make the least amount of money. It works out that actually, player A playing penny and player B playing dime is the best move. The perfect move, if you want to call back to 5-ish minutes ago. This leads us to our next question. Even in a convoluted game like this, is it possible to find the perfect move no matter the matrix? To start, we can go back to our matrix from before and analyze the cell. We notice that negative 1 is the maximum of the column, or that assuming player B plays time, negative 1 is the best we can do. It also works out that if we take the best possible case for each coin player B can play, the maximums of each column, negative 1 is the minimum of each maximum. We call this the minimax, or the worst of the best possible cases. Connecting the dots a bit, we can also see that negative 1 is actually the minimum of that row, not the maximum, which is the idea of what is the worst that can happen if I play penny. This is the opposite of before, which was what is the best that can happen if they play penny. Knowing this, we also take the minimum of each row and then find that negative 1 is actually the max of the mins, or the best of the worst case scenarios for each coin. You might have guessed this, but we call this the maxi min. Okay, so this is kind of random, but does it lead somewhere? Yes, actually, it does. It turns out that if both the maxi min and the mini max refer to the same cell, we have what is called a saddle point, or the perfect move. In the case of our game matrix, both the maxi min and the mini max refer to the cell where A plays penny and B plays dime. That cell is a perfect move. Another reminder though, a perfect move doesn't mean that the player will win, it is just the best possible move in that situation. Hopefully that made sense, but I think it would be helpful to look at another game. Let's say we have a similar setup, but a random set of rules made this matrix player A's payoff matrix. I recommend pausing for a bit to try and find the saddle point for yourself, but I'll move on anyway. Using what we just learned, we want to find the worst of the best possible outcomes and the best of the worst possible outcomes, and see if they refer to the same cell. To start with the minimax, the best we can do if player B plays penny is plus 1 for penny, then plus 5 for nickel, and plus 10 for dime. It's worth noting that in the penny column, there are 2 plus 1s. That's fine, which just means this column has 2 maximums. The minimum of these maximums is plus 1, which, as a reminder, means that the worst we can do in a best case scenario is gain 1 cent. On the other hand, if we take the maximum, we find the mins to be negative 1, negative 5, and negative 10. The maxi min is negative 1. But wait a second, those don't reference the same cell, so what now? That means there is simply no saddle point, no perfect move. So that's it. To answer our question, some games, but not all, have these perfect moves, and if you can ever find yourself making a payoff matrix, I suggest going ahead and seeing for yourself if there's a saddle point. As I leave you, one quick problem I recommend doing is creating a payoff matrix for the classic rock, paper, scissors, and seeing if there is the best possible move. If you enjoyed this video, you might enjoy the video on my left, where I win Desmos' official math competition with a penguin, or the video on my right, where I make a rickroll in Desmos. Thanks, see you in either video, and have a great rest of your day.